Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Respectability webinar for November 22nd, 2016. I hope everyone is having a great day and is great plans ahead for Thanksgiving on Thursday. I know I'm very excited about the holiday, but I'm also really excited about our learning opportunity today. Today we're going to be talking about the work of Ernst & Young, and they're a really incredible employer who's been doing some amazing work around inclusion, about tapping into the talents of people with disabilities, and they've taken a very interesting and very specific focus recently, specifically around mental health issues and the issue of addiction in the workplace. And the head of that work has been Lori Golden. She's been doing some amazing work for years around including the talents of people with disabilities into the talent pipelines of innovative employers. And I'm excited to learn from her today and to ask her some questions and to kind of have a real conversation about what Ernst & Young has been doing and what it means to really kind of thoughtfully address issues of mental health and addiction in the workplace. As ever, our Respectability webinar series has been provided by the generous support of J.P. Morgan Chase & Company. They allow us the flexibility to offer you, our audience, free webinars with closed captioning, and they've been a wonderful partner in our webinar program. We have several more webinars between now and the end of the year. We'll talk about those at the end of our presentation today. And let me do a quick introduction to Lori, and then I will turn it over to her. So Lori Golden is Ernst & Young's Abilities Strategy Leader, driving efforts to build an enabling and inclusive work environment for people of all abilities. She consults on accommodations and career development issues for EY, people working with differing abilities, and advises the firm's Access Abilities Professional Resource Network. Lori leads initiatives to enhance ergonomics and accessibility in EY's offices, communications, meetings, trainings, and technology, and educates EY's young people on ability-related issues. She is a member of the U.S. Department of Labor's Circle of Champions and actually serves on the board of directors for the U.S. Business Leadership Network, as well as Transcend, a nonprofit helping youth with disabilities to transition from school to competitive employment. She's been very involved with AAPD and USBLN's efforts around the Disability Equality Index. She has been with EY for 15 years and is a graduate of Harvard University. So as you can tell, she is one smart lady. She has knowledge, experience, passion for these issues. And so with I'm turning it over to you, Lori.
Wow, I like that intro. Knowledge, experience, and passion. Well, you all know that the passion is perhaps more important than anything. And that, I may say, I do have. It's really a great pleasure to talk to you today about one of the initiatives that we're most proud of at EY, and I must say this is a collaborative effort. It grew out of a recognition on the part of our Accessibilities Resource Network, which is focused on issues around working with diverse abilities at EY, that mental illness, and we regard addiction as part of mental illness. It is technically, but we break those out in the way we talk about it just to remind people, because many people don't really realize that addiction, substance use disorders are regarded as mental illnesses and therefore regarded as disabilities. Our initiative, as I mentioned, grew out of a recognition by Accessibilities that this was a huge area of non-visible disabilities that we weren't really addressing. And needless to say, substance use, as we all know, has been increasing very rapidly in our society, and it was a growing issue that and mental illness itself within EY. So we looked for a way to address it, and I'll discuss the genesis in a little while. But it's really been a collaborative effort between Accessibilities, and our talent organization, and specifically our employee assistance program, EY Assist, who has provided a range of both informational and therapeutic services to our people for a long, long time, and has been a leader in continually kind of providing more and more benefits to make our people's lives easier and more comfortable, but now kind of has stepped up to the plate to tackle this very, very tough topic. And the kind of theme of our effort is the idea of asking one another a very simple question: are you okay? So we refer to it as our Are You Okay initiative. Before I get into what it is we're doing and how we're doing it, wanted to provide a little bit more context. Mental illness is a critical issue in the U.S. today. You may know that 1 in 4 adults experience mental illness in a given year. Mood disorders are the 3rd major cause of hospitalizations for 18 to 44-year-olds. Serious mental illness costs $193 billion in lost earnings per year. Less than a third of adults with mental illness receive treatment, and that number drops, or I should say that percentage drops by half in communities of color. So we're talking the vast majority of people with mental illness don't get regular treatment. And we've all read the papers, so unfortunately it's probably no surprise to hear that unintentional overdose deaths from prescription pain relievers have quadrupled since 1999. This has direct, very negative impacts in the workplace. Economically, it costs employers $80 to $1 billion per year. At any given time, 1 in 10 employees is experiencing depression. Just depression alone costs $400 million in lost work days per year, which results in $52 billion losses in absenteeism and reduced productivity. Now, the impacts of all of this, beyond the economic impacts, are the impacts on individuals and how they function cognitively and how they interact in the workplace. So individuals who are impacted by mental illness have work quality suffer, professional behavior and interactions can be impacted, the ability to develop and sustain good relationships with peers can be impacted, and all of this taken together impacts not only the individual, but entire teams of people, groups of people, and overall effectiveness, productivity, and profitability of the organization. So what is a very significant and growing problem for society has become a huge, huge problem for employers. But it's a very, very difficult thing to figure out how to address. And I'm happy to say EY is one of a number of leading employers beginning to focus on this issue. Here's a little bit of our history. I mentioned that our Accessibility's Professional Resource Group had first identified a need to do more around this issue. So we had talked about it for a long time, but in 2015, our resource group piloted a series of what we called mental illness readers theater workshops in our offices. We did pilots in three different offices where we ran essentially a storytelling program where colleagues read aloud true stories of how mental illness and addiction had impacted other colleagues. And the stories were genericized, so privacy was preserved. And if people have questions, I can tell them a little bit more about how it worked. But suffice to say that we got an absolutely outstanding reception from our people. They were hungry to focus on this topic. They were hungry for information. And based on the success of these pilots, we took a step back and said, okay, what can the firm do across the board and more comprehensively? So we began work on a very comprehensive education and awareness effort, not only aimed at educating people about the issues, but really preparing people to have constructive conversations with one another so that colleagues could support colleagues. In 2015, our chairman, Steve Howe, participated in the first CEO roundtable on mental illness in the workplace at the New York Stock Exchange. That was for Disabilities Employment Awareness Month in October, hosted by the National Alliance on Mental Illness. In 2016, this year, we became a National Alliance on Mental Illness stigma-free company, which means we have pledged to do, as I mentioned, introduce a very comprehensive education and an awareness effort. And as part of that, to share that as broadly as possible with others so that they can learn from our experience. And that's what this webcast is all about. We recently sponsored a multi-city conference sponsored by or hosted by the Mayor's Fund in New York City, which brought together mental health advocates and policymakers from cities around the country to share leading ideas in how to increase access to mental health care for city residents, and in particular, disadvantaged populations. So we helped sponsor that conference and spoke on an employers panel at the conference. And just this September, after about 9-10 months of working on the program, we officially launched Are You Okay, which is a U.S. effort. Some applications we're introducing in Canada, and we're hoping that it's a forerunner of programs that we may introduce in other regions of Ernst & Young as well. But for now, it is a U.S. effort. So, I mentioned it's called Are You Okay? And what the slide shows is a little snippet from posters that we put up for Disabilities Employment Awareness Month in all our offices promoting Are You Okay? So this is just a snippet, and it shows a post-it note that says, Are You Okay? In text language. Are You Okay? Is an awareness and education campaign around mental illness and addiction that first and foremost is designed to equip our people to support our people. So rather than just educating our people and creating an expectation that managers and the firm will address this issue, we want to empower individuals to address the issue directly by having conversations with their peers. and it's aimed at supporting colleagues, not just who may have mental illness or addiction themselves, but the many, many people who are impacted by mental illness or addiction or substance use within their families, among friends, or even by their colleagues, because when one individual is impacted, many individuals, you know, in that person's orbit are impacted, and we're very mindful of that. So Are You Okay takes a three-pronged approach. There's education. We've created training and produced tools. We want to significantly increase awareness, and we've written articles in our online daily newsletter, created posters, created banners. There are leader messages from many different firm leaders in many different contexts that promote and reference this effort. And then the final piece is direct engagement. And taking a page from what we did with Reader's Theater, we are asking people to get directly engaged with this effort in a couple of ways. One is we solicited people, especially people in our accessibilities network, to become what we call our Are You Okay advocates. And those are peers who have taken the in-depth training that has been created, and I'll go through that in a minute, and who are responsible for encouraging their colleagues to take the training and to ask the Are You Okay question and to support the effort on the ground. And the final way that we ask them to support efforts on the ground is by attending Are You Okay events that we're holding in many of our key offices. They're 90-minute events, and I'll get to those in a little while. So, the education piece. We have created, and this was created by the Accessibilities Network, very quick colleague-to-colleague videos on how to have an Are You Okay conversation. So those videos are each about a minute and 20 seconds. They're narrated by members of our network, speaking in very kind of practical ways to EY colleagues, saying, this is why mental illness and addiction matters at EY. This is how it impacts us. This is how to spot if someone you know may be struggling with the impacts. This is what to look for. This is how to prepare to have a conversation. And this is what to ask. And you know, some of the actual kind of words you can use to have a quick conversation to show that you care, that you're willing to listen, and rather than diagnose or problem solve, how to refer to expert resources. And we're lucky to have great resources at EY with our employee assistance program. And we also refer to community resources, chiefly to the National Alliance on Mental Illness in each location. We have also created, our employee assistance program has created, very comprehensive online 30-minute training programs that are available on demand. And those training programs are focused on what people should know about mental illness and addiction and its impacts, and how to be supportive of colleagues and peers. And there are three different trainings. There is about a 45-minute training that was created for our HR organization, so that's a little bit more in-depth because our talent professionals have a little bit more responsibility to take an active role in this. There was a training specifically created for our executives and our leaders, And then there was a third training, and this is the basic 30-minute training created for all EY people, so created for colleagues or peers. So two different kinds of training, one, the in-depth online training, and two, the very, very quick videos, which anyone can view, kind of look at those as a crib sheet for the whole Are You Okay methodology, how to have an Are You Okay conversation. In terms of building awareness, we've used a range of communications to position why this is so critical, to encourage our people to take the trainings, to promote more openness around these issues, and begin to reduce the stigma that still very much attaches to mental illness and especially to addiction issues. So we've used a lot of different ways to get those messages across, from communications by our leaders, whether it's our chairman's regular blog or it's firm-wide webcasts, or messages sent by leaders in our lines of businesses. We've promoted the trainings, the events, and the videos. We've had specific messages, a whole range of messages for our talent organization. There have been many articles in our firm's online daily newsletter, some of them even including kind of self-quizzes to test your knowledge on a particular mental illness that's very common, like anxiety or depression. We've had banners and posters and electronic signage in our offices, and we've even created special email signature messages and instructions for those who have taken the training on how to promote that others take the training and how to promote the overall effort with a message that appears automatically at the bottom of one's email signature. The final piece I talked about, so there was education and awareness, is live engagement. And I mentioned that Accessibility's created a 90-minute in-person learning event and created a very comprehensive toolkit of everything that is required to put together that event, from work plans to email messages to everyone in an office, to email messages to invite leaders of other resource networks to participate and get their members to participate. There are probably 40 pages of detailed worksheets, templates for posters and promotional messages that were put together. And the event is always hosted by the top leader in each of the offices, and that's our office managing partner. And that's a way of adding heft and credibility to the effort. It's also a way of getting people to turn out because people are more interested in turning out at events that are hosted by important leaders. And the event really has three pieces. One, taking a page from what we did with Reader's Theater, our video stories told by EY people, real stories, real people videotaped, talking about the impacts of their own or friends or family members' mental illness or addiction. And we have five different people telling their stories. They're all at different levels in our firm, several of our highest level leaders, several more at staff members, so younger members, and in all different functions and in all different areas of our business to show kind of the variety of what impacts can be. And among those six different stories, the planning team for each of these events chooses two that they feel are most representative and most impactful for the population of that office. And they play two of those videos. And then there is a discussion facilitated. The event is opened up by the office managing partner, and then a discussion is facilitated by the highest level talent professional, highest level HR professional in that office around those videos, just to open up discussion. So that is the first piece, the making this real for our people and how it impacts our people. The second piece of the program is really the how-to, and that's where the videos that I mentioned featuring members of the Accessibility Network come in. And those are four very, very quick videos, again, on how this impacts our people and how to spot signs that somebody may be struggling. And we've boiled this down into kind of nine quick behaviors or indicators to look for. How to get ready to have a conversation, how to have a conversation and what to say, and then where to refer to inside and outside the firm. So the videos kind of lay it all out in about 4.5 minutes total, and then we have two HR people, two talent team people, facilitate a discussion with the audience around how to do this and to field any questions about what if this comes up and what do I do if that. And that is kind of the centerpiece of our program. And then the final part of the program, you know, really is a deeper dive into resources. So we'll have a very, very quick 3-minute presentation from kind of three different representatives. One from our Accessibilities Resource Network. We'll have the leader of the Resource Network in that office talk about the resources that we develop at Accessibilities around non-visible disabilities and about all the issues we focus on at Accessibilities and invite people to join the network. We have our representative from our employee assistance program talk about what our employee assistance program offers and how to get in contact with them. And then finally, we invite a local representative from the National Alliance on Mental Illness to come into our office and talk about the classes and support groups and events and information available in that community specifically, so that our people get insight into what's available for our people through the firm, but then what more is available in the community and outside the firm. So they can share that with family members and everyone they know, and they can take advantage of the whole plethora of resources that are available. We have been rolling out the Are You Okay events through the fall. We will have a bit of hiatus from holiday time right through tax season. That's our busy season. And at EY, we don't have any live events there then. So we will be picking up again in May, which is Mental Health Awareness Month. And we'll have another flight of large Are You Okay events in our offices. Meanwhile, we are busy creating smaller learning events in smaller group settings. So we're busy kind of creating a format to have maybe half-hour versions of the program for individual teams that work together, for groups that we call counseling families, that are groups of EY people that get together quarterly to talk about firm issues and talent issues, and smaller sessions that we may make available by service line. So that's by line of business. We are measuring outcomes and gathering stories. We have already seen a huge increase in calls to our employee assistance program. All of the events, and we've done 4 so far, live Are You Okay events, have had standing room only crowds. Our people are really, really interested in the subject matter. And one of the most frequent comments we get back is, you know, what next can we do in this office around this topic? We are sharing what we're doing with everybody we can, both inside and outside EY. So we'll be happy to share our playbook as well as our lessons learned. And we very much are anxious to promote what the National Alliance on Mental Illness is doing overall in encouraging companies to develop programs like this to reduce stigma both within their organizations and in our communities broadly. So we are happy to do whatever we can to share information about the National Alliance on Mental Illness's stigma-free company program and to share information on what we're doing here at EY. That's it. I am ready for questions.
Okay. Lori, thank you so much for your very thorough presentation there. I was furiously taking notes about everything. For our listeners today, I want you to know that we'll be posting a video recording of this webinar on our YouTube channel after the holiday. We will also be posting an audio recording on our website at respectabilityusa.org. So if you want to go back and refer to anything you heard today from Lori, we'll have that option in a few days. Give us a chance to enjoy Thanksgiving, and then we'll make sure you get a copy. As I've indicated in the chat box, if anybody would like to request now a PDF copy of the presentation, just email me at philipp@respectabilityusa.org, and I'll get that out to you before the end of the day. Now, as for questions, I know I have a bunch, but I'm sure the audience has a lot more. So, operator, could you please explain to folks on the phone how they can ask a question?
Absolutely. Submit a chat question. Please type in your question in the Q&A window, which is in the lower left corner of the presentation screen, and type in your question and click on the Ask button.
Great. All right. So I think one of the first questions we have is from Valentini Caligairo, who did a webinar with us a while ago. And I think you touched on this, Lori, but I think it's worth revisiting. So Valentini's question was, as you know, there is still a lot of stigma around depression. So how likely are employees with mental illness, and specifically employees with depression, to come out of the closet? In addition, how does EY take proactive steps towards that purpose?
Great question. And, you know, absolutely, there's enormous stigma around depression. We are... Through the Are You Okay program, we are looking to create models of individuals who are open about having depression. One of the videos, actually several of the videos that we feature in the program are around depression. One features an EY partner talking about his wife's depression and substance use and the impact on the family. And one is an EY partner talking about her own postpartum depression and how it impacted her. So we're setting an example of people at leadership levels who are coming out, if you will, around those issues. When the office managing partner begins the program, we urge that individual to tell a story about mental illness or addiction or substance use and impacts in his or her own life. It could be a friend in the past. It could be a colleague. It could be a family member. It could be his or her own experience. But we are, in every session where we have a top leader presenting, having open up the topic, having a top leader kind of set the tone by creating a personal reference point. Now, it may not be his or her own issues, but it opens up by saying, I too have a personal connection to this, and creates more of a safe space. I want to clarify, we are not encouraging people to openly discuss that they have mental illness or addiction with everybody in the workplace. That's not the purpose of this. The purpose of this is to create an environment where colleagues are looking out for one another and noticing if somebody may be suffering or struggling, and knowing how, when you notice that, to show some empathy and show some caring by asking a question, saying the door is open to talk to me, showing a willingness to talk and to listen. And then by directing that person to resources, be it, you know, in the community through NAMI or other community resources, or our own employee assistance program or professionals that they may already know. We are not encouraging individuals in a conversation to say to colleagues, you know, I'm glad you asked that, I have depression. We are encouraging individuals to say, you know, thank you for asking. Yes, I have, you know, I have struggled with, or just thank you for asking. It's good to know that these resources are available. It's up to the individual whether the individual wants to be open and who that individual wants to be open with. But we are not going so far as to encourage an environment where everybody comes out, so to speak. We want to encourage an environment where everybody looks out for one another and everybody knows where to get help and how to refer to help. So it's a little bit nuanced.
Interesting, very interesting, and that's a very delicate balance to strike. And I think it feeds into two things. I know there's a gentleman, Niraj Patel, has been posting a lot in the chat box. I would certainly encourage you to email me so we can carry the conversation online, offline. And then going back to the issue of disclosure, Nancy specifically asked, how do you handle confidentiality issues? And I think you touched on that a little bit.
We, you know, in these colleague-to-colleague conversations, again, we are not necessarily expecting colleagues to divulge sensitive personal information, but they may. And in the trainings and in the videos and any time we talk about this, we're saying, you know, this is a really privileged setting where you're asking a question of somebody, and that person is making, you know, him or herself vulnerable. So it goes without saying that unless the individual is in extreme danger of harming him or herself or harming someone else, and then we have a responsibility to notify somebody in human resources. If there is an acute danger, we teach our people that there is a responsibility to notify an HR professional and who that HR professional is. But barring that, these conversations are private, they're confidential, and the purpose is to help by listening, help by caring, and help by referring. We emphasize that it is not to take an active role by giving someone's manager a heads up or colleague a heads up or helping an individual solve the problem or giving advice or diagnosing. It's to help by listening, by willingness to listen on an ongoing basis and to be there, and by referring.
Gotcha. Very interesting. Very. I'm glad you're very sensitive to the complexities involved here. So we have a question from the Chicago Community Trust, which specifically asked, is knowing your rights under the ADA for accommodations part of the presentation or education process for EY employees?
Absolutely. Yes. when individuals are hired in our onboarding training, individuals go on our website and they, in a classroom setting, learn how to navigate various pieces of our website. And one of the areas that they're given to navigate, as an example, is our accommodations policy. So from day one, we draw their attention to it. Obviously, you know, it's posted, you know, in our online policy manual, and when they go to the new hire portal, when individuals go to a new hire portal, and they're signing up, you know, for various things and learning about our resource networks. And so forth, they have an opportunity to self-identify. And there is also information on our accommodations policy and how to request an accommodation.
Gotcha. Wonderful. This question comes from Phyllis Hayes, who says, are your events held all over the country? And if so, may non-EY companies attend or borrow your resources?
We would love for them to be in every office. They are not. We are going from office to office in a very grassroots way. We feel that part of the success of this is that it is really peer-to-peer. So it is our accessibilities resource group that created the toolkit and is taking the initiative, but then our accessibilities resource group kind of has an open casting call in the office to ask who would like to be on a planning committee for this event. So anyone in the office who has an interest in the subject matter can participate in putting the actual event together. which is a way of, you know, kind of broadening the scope and welcoming more into the community. And then the accessibilities leader also approaches our other resource networks in that location and asks them to co-sponsor the event. So the event is sponsored by 4 or 5 different networks, which really makes it, you know, of our people, you know, by our people, and for our people. So no, it's for EY people, and in, by design, we very much want to keep it intimate. I think if we had people outside the firm other than our guests from NAMI or, you know, kind of one or two other selected guests, that would undermine some of the kind of EY family intimate feel that we try to create. That said, we are very, very happy to share what we're doing and how we're doing it, our playbook, if you will, for these events with any organization who's interested in taking a look at what we're doing and, you know, learning from it, modeling from it. So please, you know, reach back to me, you know, offline after this call if you're interested, and I'd be happy to share. We're sharing on a one-on-one basis our videos. The pure videos that I mentioned are already up on our public website. So on ey.com/abilities, on that first page, right when you go to that site, you will see a headline on the right side menu saying, you know, why mental illness is, why addressing mental illness is important at EY. And you'll see our peer-to-peer video, you know, one of the videos that we use, the how-to video that we use in these sessions.
Gotcha. Wonderful. So we had a different question from Robert DeMichelis, who specifically asked, where would you recommend folks in human resource departments at companies go for resources and information about disclosure, accommodations, and the risks involved? And he specifically asked if you would recommend people looking at EEOC or the DOJ.
Absolutely. You know, absolutely look at EEOC and DOJ. We have actually published back on our website a guidebook that the Accessibilities Network created several years ago. That isn't legal advice. It's not what you're going to get from EEOC or DOJ. It's more of a deep dive into some of the interpersonal issues that can come up when an individual is working with a non-visible disability. So, you know, how do you handle it if peers ask you where you're going when you're actually, you know, kind of leaving for, an approved therapy appointment, and you don't want to kind of say that explicitly, nor do you want to lie. So, you know, how do you handle questions like that? Or, you know, how do you handle it if there are changes in an individual's schedule due to an accommodation and not everybody knows why those changes were made, but the changes impact the whole team and sometimes are inconvenient for the team. And, you know, if individuals are uncomfortable about that, and they really don't understand the reasons, nor can they. So, kind of how do you handle those issues? They're really, really tough. So we put together a guidebook, and it's on our resources page. So if you go to ey.com/abilities, and you look under resources, It's called Getting Support, Supporting Others, a Handbook for Working with Non-Visible Disabilities. And that delves into some of the interpersonal issues beyond the legal issues.
Wow. Okay. Well, it certainly sounds like something well worth reading. All right. So I'm going to use the last chat box question of the day. It comes from Valerie Martin, who asked kind of a couple interrelated questions. So she asked, did EY have a reflection about how practices of managers can impact the mental health of employees if the actions of top leaders are in contradiction with what is promoted in the initiatives? Employees might perceive contradictory and incoherent messaging, which could be a cultural problem. And then are issues of managerial style as they relate to mental health addressed as part of the materials for your events?
Yes. And those are keen observations. Couldn't agree more. If there's a contradiction between what we're teaching here and the kind of culture we're aiming to create, and the actions of individual managers and leaders, there's going to be a real disconnect, and that's going to be upsetting to people. And we can't control for the mindset of every manager, but what we can do is train our managers proactively, and we've done that with this effort. The training is designed to help our managers and our leaders develop some sensitivity or develop greater sensitivity and fluency with how to deal with these issues. We expect our leaders to be role models for creating what we call our culture of caring, a culture in which people really look out for one another and recognize that if one person on a team is struggling, the entire team is impacted. So it just makes sense for all of us to do whatever we can to create an environment where people can feel and do their best. I'm happy to say that when we have been running these in-person events, the Are You Okay events, and we ask our leaders to share a personal story, we've been just incredibly impressed with the vulnerability and that they've shown and how candid that they've been. One of our leaders in one office, we don't know what they're going to say. We just say, tell a story, that shows a personal connection to. And one of our leaders, rather than kind of standing up on the dais, came out and walked in the audience and talked about his own daughter having anxiety issues and how that impacted his entire family. And then the next leader who was facilitating the next section talked about his sister and some very serious issues that his sister had and how that impacted him, and how at one point he realized that he was really depressed. And this is why, while he was working at the firm, and he sought help while he was working at the firm, and setting that tone, goes a long way in creating expectations among our people and a mindset among our managers and leaders that we want to be caring. We want to be open. Vulnerability is good.
Wow. And I think that's a really powerful note to end on it. Thank you very much, Lori Golden, for sharing your experiences and your insights with us today. Before we finish up, I'm just going to quickly run our audience through some of our upcoming webinars. We're kind of covering a range of diverse topics in the next couple weeks before the year ends, and I invite you to attend any and all that are of interest. So, the webinars that we offer are offered free with closed captioning and accessibility thanks to the generous support of J.P. Morgan Chase & Company. We want to extend Chase our deepest thanks for both being a model employer, for supporting things like the Conference Accessibility Initiative, and supporting our own work to promote best practices in disability employment. Next Monday on November 28th at 1:30 p.m., we're going to be having a really special conversation with Timothy Shriver, the chairman of Special Olympics, and we're specifically going to be talking about training for police officers in interacting with people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. Some estimates show that up to 50% of the officer-involved shootings we hear about on the news involve people with one form of disability or another. We have seen numerous stories of young people with disabilities who, as a result of a police interaction, died. And there has been numerous stories here across the country. Special Olympics has up and done a lot of outreach in training police officers how to interact with people with disabilities in a sensitive and efficient manner. And so we're going to be talking with Timothy Shriver and a few others from Special Olympics about those interactions and the training they've done. I hope you all will be able to join us for that conversation. After that, on Tuesday, December 6th at 1:30 p.m., I'm going to be joined by Eddie Ellis and Janie Jeffers, two of my collaborators on a report that we released back in June about criminal justice reform and people with disabilities. A lot of people don't know that the Bureau of Justice Statistics found that 32% of people in prison and 40% of people in jail reported having at least one disability. What that means is that there are hundreds of thousands of Americans with disabilities of one form or another in the prison system interacting with the criminal justice system every day as victims, as alleged perpetrators, and as returning citizens who are returning to society and hoping to reintegrate back home. So this is going to be a very special conversation. Eddie is a returning citizen. He spent 15 years in prison, and actually 10 of those years were in solitary confinement. He is a person with a disability. He has become a very powerful advocate for criminal justice reform, and he'll be talking about his personal experiences. And likewise, Janie actually has experience managing correctional systems and will be providing her own insight in terms of how do you have a fair and just system that serves people with disabilities and serves the interests of the law. I hope you'll be able to join us on December 6th. Following that on Wednesday, so the first week of December is going to be really busy for us, we're actually joined by Tad Asbury of the Marriott Foundation for People with Disabilities, and he's going to be talking about the efforts of the Bridges from School to Work program on Wednesday, December 7th at 1:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. He's going to be talking about the transformative power of the job and the Bridges program. I hope you'll be able to join us to talk about their work. And then lastly, we're going to be having a great conversation with Derek Shields from the National Disability Mentoring Coalition about the intersection between mentoring and disability employment. His collaborative has been doing a lot of great work about pairing young people with disabilities who are going into professional careers, connecting them with mentors, empowering them, developing their skills, and we're really glad to be joining with Derek on Tuesday, December 13th at 1:30 p.m. Eastern. I hope you'll be able to join us for one or all of our webinars. We're in the process now of developing an entire slate of new webinars around career pathways, around states, around innovative programs in the coming months, and I hope you'll be able to join us for these webinars between now and the end of the year and all of our future webinars. Again, thank you to Chase for providing the resources and the webinar series. Thank you, Lori, for sharing your insights, and that concludes today's broadcast.